Good evening. I'm Carolyn McGrath, and welcome to the last event of Hopewell Valley Green Week. Green Week is a series of online and in-person events in Hopewell Valley organized by the HVRSD Green Team around the theme of environmental challenges and solutions. We are going on our second year of programming for Green Week, and this year we have chosen to focus on the urgent issue of climate change. Tonight's program will be on decarbonizing your home, presented by Joanne Held and members of the Hopewell Valley Green Team. So Joanne, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Great. Well, thank you. I'm glad to have all of you with us tonight. Really happy to be talking about this topic. We're calling it Decarbonize Your Home. And well, that's a pretty ambitious topic. We think that we have to be ambitious in these times. And we don't expect that at the end of this session, you'll have your to-do list and you'll just get it all done in the next few months. But this is a chance for us to talk about what the steps would be, why you would want to decarbonize your home, what the steps are, and for you to decide what your next step is. So that's where that's how we've organized our thoughts for tonight. The way we use energy at home and the way that we drive our cars makes a significant contribution to the overall emissions of carbon in this country. In the latest New Jersey DEP inventory of greenhouse gas emissions, they found that about 10% of the greenhouse gas emissions in New Jersey are from residential energy, and about 27% are from on-road gasoline vehicles. So that constitutes a significant part of the whole overall greenhouse gas emissions. And we can really make a big difference in what happens in New Jersey and around the country. And if we want to meet the carbon reduction goals that have been set by our cities, our state, and our nation as a whole, for example, New Jersey, Pennington has a carbon neutral by 2035 goal. And New Jersey has a 80% reduction by 2050 goal for the whole state. And those are pretty big, ambitious goals. If we want to do it, we all have to make some changes by being more energy efficient, making energy choices that produce less carbon. So it's time for us to decarbonize. And by decarbonize, we mean moving away from energy systems that produce carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gas emissions. That's kind of the code that we're using. Incremental change is worthwhile. And sometimes you think, what can I do? Just my little part. But I want to share something that I got from Mike Winka, who is on our Mercer County Sustainability Coalition. And let me see if I can make this into slideshow. Sorry. Play from start. I wanted to show you a slide that he put together and then also that DEP put together. And I can't see anything, so I think I just messed everything up. Sorry. All right. There you go. I'm just going to just show this slide and you can, for the moment. There we go. So this is where we want to make sure we started on time so I could get over all of these humps. Let's see if I can make it bigger. This is a slide from the New Jersey greenhouse gas plan. Oops, here we go. And they're showing, and maybe I won't be able to show it, maybe I'll just have to describe it to you, sorry, that in New Jersey, we have been making an effort to reduce our carbon, our greenhouse gas emissions since about 2005. That's when we started keeping track. We had a goal of that by 2020, we had a goal to meet by 2020. When 2019 rolled around, we did an inventory. We were more than 20% beyond that goal. In fact, we're under the goal, meaning we're doing better than we had asked ourselves to do. And so, and that was, you know, doing simple stuff. There's a lot more ways to reduce our greenhouse gas emissions now. So we think that all those goals we're talking about actually are achievable. And So we're tonight, what we want to do is urge each of you to start making even more changes. And even if it's a small change, it can make a big difference. It's sort of like compound interest in a way. You make a small change now, but that small change continues year after year after year. And that's why we're optimistic that the changes we make are going to make a difference. Today, we're going to be, this is an interactive session. The Hopewell Valley Green Team and some of our local experts who we have invited to join us will outline a variety of options and provide lots of resources to make it easy to take your next step in decarbonizing your home. And I'm going to show a attempt one more time to show a PowerPoint. See if this works this time. I'm not going to do slideshow, but what I wanted to show you is this really cool graphic that I found online. And this really describes what we want to talk about tonight. Three steps. First, energy efficiency. There's so many things you can do to be more energy efficient at home. And those are the first few things that we'll hear about. Insulation, smart thermostats, all that kind of stuff. So first you want to be as energy efficient as possible. Then you want to go to all electric. You want to get rid of all those natural gas that you're burning in your house. Get everything to be electric. And once you've done that, you want to make sure that you obtain all the electricity you need from renewable sources. So we're going to talk in those three buckets: energy efficiency, becoming electric, and then finding renewable energy sources. And so I'm going to, so that's what you're going to, also one more thing. We're going to go really fast and just sort of skim the surface because there's so many things we could talk about, and you're all at a different place in your journey. There'll be other resources available after this. We're going to have a resource page that will be posted on our website in about a week with links to lots of other places where you can get information. Also on Thursday, the Mercer County Sustainability Coalition is hosting a session about home tools for homeowners focused on the electrification and the renewables. I'll be posting information about that on our Hopewell Valley Green Team Facebook page. If you can't find us there, just reach out to us and we'll make sure you get access to that. Also next Saturday at the, there's a green get together at Lawrence High School from 10 to 2. Our green team will be there with more information about all the things we're talking about tonight. So those are ways that you can continue to learn and keep growing. So energy efficiency is first. And so we're going to start by with a presentation by Scott Needham from Princeton Air. Many of you may know Scott since he lives right here in Pennington. And we're really happy to have a local expert who we can share with today. And he's going to be talking us through a whole lot of bits and pieces related to energy efficiency. So Scott, hopefully I can get these slides to show for you and we'll let you take over.
Thank you, Joanne. Joanne, can you click that little presentation button down there to the lower right? You know where that is? It looks, come a little left, a little more left, right there. Try that. Maybe that.
Okay. Well, when I do that, I don't see anything. Can you see it?
I think it's coming.
Okay. Oh, I just wasn't patient enough. Okay. And I'm going to view without all these people. I love seeing all your faces, but makes it harder for us. Okay.
Or we can just roll with it here. Good evening, everyone. Happy to be here. Back up what Joanne was just talking about. I think we all know the least expensive BTU there is the one you don't use. So what I'm going to be talking about in the beginning is how to seal up the home. That's kind of the loading order before you put fancy equipment in. And I even think before you do solar or upgrade your heating cooling systems, the thing to do is tighten up the shell of the home and really make that thing tight. One thing that we do is insulation and air sealing. And in any one particular home, especially the older building stock that is all around, the buildings are full of gaps, cracks, penetrations in the attic, in the basement, in the walls. And you want to really attack those first to tighten up the shell. Hey, Joanne, if it's easier, you could make me presenter and I could show some slides on my computer.
Here you go. Wait, I got it.
Okay, there you go.
Sorry.
No problem. So you can go next slide if you're able.
Yep.
See, this is what we hear many times from our customers. They talk about high energy bills, hot and cold rooms, condensation on windows, moisture in the attic or basement. And these are all indications that the shell of the building has got issues. Next slide. Again, what we talked about is all the penetrations all throughout the space. You'll see what I call the attic plane. It's the second floor ceiling. You'll see there are tons of ways that air from the bottom of the building can move up into the attic. And when the air gets up into the attic, that air is typically filled with moisture. And then in wintertime, that moisture could freeze up in the attic space. Next slide. And I don't know if this will work from your perspective, Joanne, but when this is just kind of an infographic of all the little kind of exhaust fans, if you will, in your home. You've got the dryer down in the basement off to the left. You've got maybe a bathroom exhaust fan up on the upstairs to the left. You've got other exhaust fans through the building. And when all of these are running in a home, all those little dashes in there are negatives, and you're creating negative pressure in the building. And what happens is that has the ability to sometimes pull flue gases back down through the boiler or the furnace, which is a bad situation. Next slide. And this is what we call the stack effect. So in the wintertime, when we're heating up air in the lower levels of the building, that air is becoming very buoyant, and that's moving up through the building, and it's pushing itself through all those gaps and cracks up on the second floor. While it's doing that, it needs to get what we call makeup air, and you'll see all the arrows pointing into the basement at the lower level. You're getting outside air creeping through all the gaps and cracks on the lower levels to make up and neutralize that air pressure imbalance. That's called the stack effect. Next slide. So in wintertime, if you take a look at your home after a fresh snow, if you start seeing indications on your roof line like you see here, that means you have some serious insulation problems in your building that you really want to address. That means there's lack of insulation, or it's fallen, or it was just never put up properly, or maybe you had the cable guy up there doing some work in the attic and some of the insulation has fallen. Next slide. Again, just another infographic of where all those holes are in the attic plane. Typically, you've got insulation in those bays and it's very difficult to see. So sometimes, depending on how handy you are, you can get up there and pull some of those bad insulations up and out. You'll identify these holes. Like for an example, when the house was built and someone needed to run a piece of electrical wiring, well, they didn't drill a hole the exact size of the electrical wiring. It's probably 2 to 3 times the size of it. And that's just another channel or chaseway for air to move up into the attic. Next slide. A couple of pictures of typical stuff that we see. You see a can light fixture up on the top right. You've got, you know, a junction box or a gang box on the lower right that might be connected to a ceiling fan. And lots of times those weren't installed with caulking or sealant around them. Next slide. In a typical looking attic where you have lots of different kind of installation techniques used for installing insulation. And over time, these things can sag and fall and create those snow indications on the roof that we saw a couple slides ago. Next slide. A real problem area are the soffits above kitchen cabinets. If you ever in the middle of the winter pull out some some coffee mugs or plates, and you'll notice how chilly many of them are in many homes, that's an indication of air sealing or lack of air sealing behind those hot soffits, and those things are really problematic. The cold dishes are just an indication of a real building structure problem. Next slide. So what happens typically in an assessment is you see that what we call blower door to the left, that we open the front door or the back door, we put a blower door system in its place, and that fan at the lower left on that green door, we set that fan up to pull out X number of CFM of air out of the house. Now, prior to that, we've made sure that all the windows and the doors and the fireplace dampers are all shut. So we'll put the building under pressure, under negative pressure, and we'll measure the exact cubic feet per minute of air moving out of the building. Now, let's say we get 5,000 cubic feet of air per minute being pulled out of that blower door. That means 5,000 cubic feet per minute are being pulled in through the gaps, cracks, penetrations all throughout the building. Then the next panel you'll see, we'll walk around and look at where those gaps and cracks are by evidence of that infrared gun. And we'll be able to identify areas that we can put together a scope of work as to what's needed to be done to fix those gaps and cracks. Included with an audit is a combustion analysis on the equipment. You want to make sure that's burning properly. And sometimes we use borescopes to look and, you know, pop a panel off of an outlet, look behind it to get an indication of what kind of insulation is in that wall. Next, please. And that's just a good indication of, the hot and cold spots and where heat is moving through the structure. Now, Carolyn, great question. It can be done in the winter or the summer, these infrared scans. You just need a good temperature difference from outside to inside. So both cooling and heating, seasons work. Good questions. Next. And next. Here's some before and after shots of what we'll see on the left, and just a sheer amount of square inches of area where air can just move freely through the building. And you want to, pan that off with sheet metal, put fire caulking in, and that'll do a lot towards sealing that air movement. Next. On the left, you'll see the typical attic. Then after we're done with air sealing all the gaps and penetrations in that attic plane, oftentimes we'll blow in cellulose insulation. A lot of people say, well, goodness, that's where I keep all my Christmas decorations. Well, sometimes we'll build platforms up there to give you a little bit of storage area. And, that's a really nicely insulated attic right there. Next slide. Again, the distribution system is another problem we see. And it's very typical that you'll see old ductwork being pulled apart over years and years of use. And what we'll do is put that all back together, use what's called a mastic, the gray or white mastic to air seal or to seal the ductwork to keep all that heated and cooled air getting delivered to the proper areas in the home. Next. So Joanne asked me to talk about heat pumps and comes to the topic of beneficial electrification. And we all kind of know that as the grid continues to get cleaner by solar, wind, geothermal, and other means, that, you know, using only electric appliances in the home seems to make sense. Next slide. So heat pumps have gotten a bad rap over the years. Back in the 60s and 70s, they didn't do a very good job. You can only use them down to, say, 35 to 40 degrees outside. And then they had these big electric heaters that were used for supplemental heating, and they cost a lot of money. Nowadays, heat pumps can heat kind of down to like 5 to 10 degrees outside. So you're getting much more heat output from the unit down to very cold outdoor temperatures. And a heat pump is nothing but a unit outside that kind of looks like your air conditioner connected to an indoor air handler. And we still put electric heating, supplemental heating in those indoor air handlers. And these units will do both heating in the wintertime and cooling in the summertime. Now, people say, you know, they're amazed that when I tell them there's actually heat in the air, even at 10 degrees outside, there's heat content. And what a heat pump does is it pulls that air through the outdoor unit, and we're extracting every bit of heat out of that unit. And then we move it through the refrigeration process. There's a compressor out at the outdoor unit, and that further enhances the temperature of the refrigeration that moves through copper piping into the indoor unit, where it's then delivered to the house. Next. I don't want to get too technical, but you've got the outdoor unit on the left. We've got the cold winter air that actually has heat in it moving through the unit. The compressor does the heavy lifting that really enhances what kind of temperature the Freon gets to be then delivered inside. And this unit in the middle called the reversing valve, that's what switches it from heating to cooling. Next slide. And what we're seeing a lot of folks do now, if they can't go all in for a heat pump, there's many times we're putting in these hybrid systems. And it's combining a heat pump, the outdoor unit, with a gas furnace inside. And instead of replacing a gas furnace and an air conditioner, lots of times we're replacing a gas furnace and including a heat pump as well. And it's called a dual fuel or a hybrid system. So a dual fuel system operates. So in the milder weather, the heat pump will operate. And then there's an automatic switching component that says when it gets really cold outside, we're going to switch over to the gas furnace. Some of the fancier systems have very smart thermostats that will program in the actual utility rates on electric and gas, and the thermostat will make decisions on what to bring on, the heat pump or the gas furnace. Next slide. I think that might be all for me. Yeah, that'll do it.
I think there was a question that also was in the chat.
Let me see that chat. Possibly using a heat pump in a home with baseboard hot water heat. Yes, so that would require installing, you know, an outdoor unit and an indoor unit. And if you don't have any ductwork in the home, you'll have to bear the expense of adding the duct system. Having said that, though, we've seen a lot of people take advantage of the mini ductless split systems, Mitsubishi, Fujitsu, there's many manufacturers, and you could put those wall-mounted or ceiling-mounted or ductwork modified units, and you could use those mini ductless split heat pump systems down to pretty low temperatures outside, and have yourself use the boiler or your hot water baseboard on the super cold days. I hope that answers that.
Okay, we have time for one or two more questions on heat pumps. We'll probably circle back to this again a little bit later, just so if you have a couple more shots at asking your questions. Oh, yeah.
So the question is, we have central AC ductwork downstairs, but none upstairs. So certainly you could replace the air handler, which is serving your air conditioning needs. Actually, you might be able to, if it's a heat pump air handler, that's no problem, but you could certainly retrofit that system to put a heat pump with a new outdoor unit and probably need a new indoor unit. And then you can use that. You could even coordinate and connect the thermostat to do heating for the heat pump through your ductwork, and then having it automatically switch over to the boiler for your backup heat or for the super cold days. So yeah, that would work in your situation.
So you probably have been able to guess that, understand that heat pumps are really versatile. They have, they can help in lots and lots of different situations depending on what you need. You talk to an expert and you can get there. There's also, I understand, now heat pumps for hot water heaters. Do you have any experience with those yet, Scott, or are they just too new?
Yeah, we are seeing more and more of those getting installed. And it's certainly a no-brainer if you have an electric hot water to move to, you know, a heat pump hot water heater. When people have natural gas, you know, if they want to decarbonize and move away from fossil fuels, heat pump hot water heater is certainly the answer. And the technology of those are getting better and better. We put a bunch of them in 15, 18 years ago, had some issues, but the manufacturers really see this as the movement, and they're getting really smart with the inverter technology, which is the heart of the heat pump, which is the compressor. The compressors are becoming amazingly efficient and can deliver a lot of heat. So heat pump hot water heaters are good and getting better.
Great. There's another question in the chat about, are there concerns about radon buildup after sealing a house?
Or other— Okay, yeah, that's a great question. Yep. So what sometimes happens is that when you do a good job air sealing and insulating the home, you're stopping what's called that stack effect that I showed you on that one slide. So you're kind of tamping down the negative pressure in the basement that will pull radon gases in. Having said that, though, you probably need, depending on if you were tested and you're at a certain level, you probably want a radon mitigation system that, you know, depending on, you know, the prevailing winds and how the house is being affected by the wind outside, that can change the dynamics in the home. So, but that's a good question. Yeah, it's certainly it tends to tamp it down by air sealing and insulating the house, but certainly need means to make sure it's within certain parameters.
Great, thanks. So we'll have time for some more questions later. I just want to sort of to continue with this idea of energy efficiency and think about, you've heard now there's lots of small stuff you can do. There's sealing air leaks, increasing your insulation, maybe getting a programmable thermostat, although I would guess you almost all have one of those by now. You know, using more efficient lights like LEDs, getting everything switched over. There's more efficient appliances. And on our resource sheet, you'll be able to find links to places where when you upgrade your appliances to new Energy Star appliances, you can contact your utility and they'll not only come and take your old appliance away, but they'll give you a rebate for it. So that's a really good thing that you should consider. You'll see it on our resource list. And there's a lot of little things like that. And I want to turn this over now to Paul Kinney to talk about another way that we can, simple way, once we understand it, right, Paul, that we can help ourselves, and it's called smart outlets. So, Paul.
Okay.
Paul's a member of our green team and also on the Hopewell Township Environmental Commission. Thanks, Paul.
Okay. Hopefully I am sharing something and you can also hear me. Is that right?
Yes, it's good.
Okay. All right. So the concept of smart outlets or smart plugs This is something that, you know, I had made the personal investment a couple of years ago when they were, you know, just starting to become initially popular on the market. So this would just be a way to just introduce you to the concept and then also give you at least, you know, some of the experiences that I've found, and hopefully that can help you get started on this, because it is a fairly simple and quick hit type of opportunity here. So let me see if I can get this to move forward. Okay. So, you know, conceptually, what is a smart outlet? So you would see on the left, you just have a regular outlet that you would normally have any of your fixtures, your devices, you know, whether it be, you know, screens, space heaters, lamps, computers, any electrical items that you might have normally plugged directly into that outlet. Well, a smart plug would actually essentially, you could have those items plugged into a power strip, as is shown right there in the middle. And then you could have a smart plug that could actually have multiple devices controlled through one smart plug. It plugs into the outlet, then either the fixture electrical item or the power strip then plugs into one or more receptacles. Some of these smart outlets now will have two or more outlets directly on them. Now, what is different from, say, a typical timer device that maybe people are familiar with from the past is that these are Wi-Fi enabled. So they have some computer technology built into them. They are connected to your home's Wi-Fi. And then through some configuration, then you're able to, as is shown on the extreme right, to be able to configure, schedule, or monitor, you could either use a mobile device, your smartphone, or a web app, or both. And the one that I have, although we're not here to promote a particular brand, there are many on the market, but most of the time you can control these and set up schedules as well as monitor your consumption over time. And so probably the most difficult aspect of this is just getting it hooked up to your Wi-Fi if you're not a technical user. But essentially that small plug, which can be, you know, as little as, you know, 2 to 4 inches wide by 2 inches deep or so, it's a very small unit, but it can pack quite an impact once we show you what I've experienced, at least with one of them. So from a recommendation perspective, you're going to see many brands on the market. I'm sure you could go online. I won't recommend any particular purchase method, but you would be able to see these. Oftentimes there's the, you know, you could just go through your search engine of choice and be able to just say, hey, what are the best smart plugs or smart outlets on the market? And you would be able to get some comparisons. What I would find, though, is that you first need to make some decisions for yourself as to whether or not you're looking to deploy these either indoors or outdoors. The same unit will not work in both environments. They have specially designed units that are fit for purpose for outdoor, meaning that they are moisture resistant. They can be rained on and still maintain their operational integrity, whereas most that most people would have are indoor. My own experience has been with the indoor units, and I found that, you know, in terms of where there's usually the most opportunity to save energy is usually indoors, but you can make up your own minds on that. The other is to whether or not, as more of these units have come on more lately, is that they have, you know, voice control in the smart home technology, being able to use either Google or Amazon, you know, voice activated types of controls, as you might see with, you know, turning on, you know, other items that you may already have connected. But you don't need to use that. There is no dependency on that. And some people I know are not exactly enamored with having everything voice activated in their home. So you can have a choice, even with the units that have the capability of doing that, you don't have to make use of that particular function or feature and still get the benefit. And so the probably the more pragmatic issue is, do you have room for the plug in the area that you're looking for? My own experience has been is that, you know, as I'd shown on that prior slide, you know, space heaters, computers, TVs, these are the items that tend to, you know, consume a lot of electricity even when you are not using them. So TVs often, particularly the older flat screen TVs, will consume quite a bit of energy. And so having the ability to put a smart plug between them and the outlet and then put that on a schedule when you are normally not using that device, then you are actually saving energy just by doing that. And then the other aspect in terms of, you know, choices to make is, you know, how curious or how interested are you in monitoring your actual electric consumption? This is another area where these units differ widely. Some will give you some, you know, spot or give you a period of time, say a week or as much as a month, but they will not give you a trend that can allow you to monitor this over longer periods of time. I will show you a screen of what I chose personally that allowed me to be able to compare consumption over a two-year period, and that I found to be beneficial because oftentimes you want to make adjustments. When I first used the unit and first put it in, I realized that really my own learning curve, even though I could get it hooked up, wasn't necessarily the only learning curve to get through. Sometimes you find that you can make adjustments and improvements and you figure out what your schedule is, and then you could get even more benefits than you may have initially when you first installed the unit. So I would say that the most difficult challenge for most people who are not technical, meaning that, you know, if you don't know how your Wi-Fi was set up, then you probably are among those that would probably be best served to ask somebody's advice. And hopefully we'll have some guidance for you there. And if people do make an investment and then find themselves stuck, you know, certainly try to reach out to us and we can see what we can do to help you out. Okay, but now in terms of my own experience, you know, what I was interested in was initially indoor. I bought a set of four units and began with an installation in my home office. I'm a work from home professional. So I am often have a lot of connected items, a lot of computers that I'm using for my work. And so it was a natural area where I felt that there was probably an opportunity to be able to improve. When I'm not in the home office, I want to be able to reduce the amount of energy consumption when I'm not actually there. And so I have found when I installed one of these, just one of these, I found that to my surprise, I was probably using more than 100 kilowatts per month in my office space that I didn't need to. And so what this last slide to give you a sense of that is that on the far left, when I first was introducing the units in 2021, I did not immediately make changes to that. So what you'll see is a graph here that's in kilowatts. So roughly in hundreds, every tick line here is 100 kilowatts. Now, again, this may seem like it's more than just one unit. This is just in my office space itself in one room. And what I was consuming, I would have, since I was trying to save on energy use, again, I wouldn't find it beneficial maybe for some folks, but I found that there was an opportunity to save energy in my downstairs home office by actually not feeding heat into it. I would use a space heater, and then I would use the space heater and have that timed to turn on only when I need to be in the office. But initially, I was consuming, you know, as much as in a given month, 400 kilowatts. But then as I started to figure out how to do this, and of course, this is over a year, so don't use heat all year round. But as the summer months came in, I found that I was able to further reduce and make adjustments in the scheduling until I got to something like half of what the initial consumption is. And so I'd say that the main benefit is not necessarily how much, it's that you have the ability to put it into a specific area. You could actually move these smart plugs around. If you don't get a benefit in one area, that doesn't mean that there might not be an opportunity in another area. And so I've found that, you know, in the areas where I have TVs as well as computer systems or space heaters, that's where I've gotten the most benefit, and hopefully you would too. So from there, I could open it up to questions.
If we have some questions in the chat, sort of backing up to maybe a bit more of a discussion of what these smart outlets actually do. Is it all require programming, or does it sense that things are off, or does it depend on the smart outlet? How do you actually use it? I know you gave the space heater example, but what else, what do they do?
So essentially, you know, hopefully the diagram is showing here. So any of the items that you have plugged into, say, a power strip that plug into that unit, what that smart plug is doing, it has multiple features, but in the area of just monitoring and understanding what your consumption level is. What it's doing is it's sending as electricity is being sent through that. So it's sitting between the outlet and the consuming devices of the electricity. And it is then passively monitoring and determining what is that consumption. And then it will periodically send through the Wi-Fi to normally these are sent not to some computer system that's in your home. They're actually being sent to an online service that usually the vendor of the smart plug provides. And so your Wi-Fi is actually being able to connect it to the internet. So it's just sending to your own personal account that you have control of. It will then send periodic consumption rates of all the devices that are pulling electricity through that unit. And then on the right, you could either go to your computer or to your mobile device and then just be able to open that up and then be able to identify if you have multiple units, you can scroll through the list. And then at that point, you could just click on that or tap on it with your finger, and then it will show you what your consumption rate is. And then you can make choices usually as to what period of time, you know, on is it on an hourly, a daily, a weekly, monthly, or yearly basis. And so that is probably what I think is the most beneficial, is to at least see what these items are consuming in terms of electricity, and then using the scheduling mechanism to reduce that consumption rate. Hopefully that gives you a better explanation.
You know, it reminds me of the kilowatt meter that we were suggesting to people to use 15 years ago or something, where you would put it in between the outlet and the appliance and you'd be able to see how much it was drawing, especially when it was actually not in use, all that phantom use. And so this would tell you, I assume, something about your phantom use, what's happening when you're not using maybe your TV, and it would give you a better idea of whether or not you need to fully turn it off or just let it go.
Absolutely. Please. Yes. Now, I mean, I found that when I first plugged it in, I left it plugged in and I didn't establish a schedule at all, just to do just that, just to kind of monitor what was the consumption. And then it could give me an hourly level of consumption to see, okay, I'm not there. I know I'm not using the unit. What is that consumption rate, you know, during those wee hours of the morning or something like that? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, you can drill into these pretty granular.
Yeah. So the follow-up question in the chat is, so would you actually, once you get to the scheduling mode, would it just turn off everything that's going through that outlet when you told it to, like between 10 p.m. and 8 a.m. or something like that?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, what I do with my office, I mean, there's times, you know, the kind of the fine tuning of this is that, you know, I can't always predict when I need to be in my office. So I would have kind of a default schedule that says, okay, from 7 p.m., I'm not going to, usually not working that late, turn it off. And then I would have it set to have a regularly scheduled every 2 hours turn off. I would actually set redundant off signals so that if I manually, because this mobile device can be used to turn on the unit. So if I need to make use of my office, I'll turn it on. But then, hey, I get distracted, get called by family, I got to run and do something, I forget to turn it off. By having a repetitive schedule of like every 2 hours I have in my office, I have it turn off automatically every 2 hours afterward until the moment in time in the morning, say an hour before I arrive, I'd have it turn on, power up, or at least make power available to the system. So I'm able to probably cut the consumption probably almost in half in terms of some of these, you know, like computers, you know, they oftentimes are more consumers of electricity because they can be, you know, essentially asleep, but still they'll wake up periodically to do something. And then now they're going to almost full consumption. Mm-hmm. So, you know, hopefully having that regularly scheduled off and then having your default on and default off, and then just, you can set by exception, just manually through the device. Mm-hmm. And that's really just open up the device, tap it, and then tap through, find the item that I want, and I can turn it on. So it's fairly convenient.
Great. Well, thank you, Paul.
Sure. Absolutely.
So I think we're going to move on. We can come back to this topic again if people wish to later, but we're going to move on to a deeper discussion of electrification now. You know, Paul's talking about being as efficient as you can with all your electric devices. And I think, Paul, you're still sharing.
Yeah, that's the challenge, is to turn it off.
The fish are nice, but and you want to switch as much as away from fossil fuels wherever you can, then your ultimate goal is to be just using electricity, but the least amount of possible electricity. And then you'll want to get all that from renewable energy. So that's our flow today. Scott already introduced the idea of heat pumps, which will give you the opportunity to switch away from some of your fossil fuel heating, especially, or if you have gas HVAC air conditioning for some reason, or from your gas water heater, you know, the heat pumps will help you to move away from that. Another item we've been hearing a lot about lately is induction cooktops. And those are, that's the latest thing in cooking from what I can tell. And they use electromagnetic field instead of the flame or the heating of a surface. And they're super efficient. They transfer energy directly from to your pot or your pan instead of making a hot stovetop. And they have the advantage cooks really like that, the instantaneous temperature adjustment. And also the cooktop is never hot when it's in use. There's no indoor air pollution from it. They cost more though. So I think this is the sort of thing where everybody should keep in the back of their minds that an induction cooktop might be one of the ways you electrify your house if you're using a gas stove. If you're using an electric stove right now, then induction cooktop might be your next upgrade. When it's time to change your cooktop, maybe consider moving to an induction cooktop because it would be more efficient than what you're using now. So energy efficiency, electrification, those are our two things that we're trying really hard to push. The third thing that we're going to suggest to you tonight in our rapid review of all of this is electric vehicles. So it's going to be easier and easier to buy an electric vehicle in the next few years. It's hard right now because everybody's trying to buy them, but it's going to be easier and more affordable to buy an electric vehicle. But once you bring it home, you also need to charge it. And so one of the questions that people ask is, you know, what kind of charging station do I need? And I'm just going to share some anecdotal stuff and then suggest something from our resource page. Some of my neighbors who have electric vehicles have really short commutes. So all they ever do is a short commute. When they get home at night, they just use a regular outlet and plug it in because they're just topping off their battery. They don't need to do a whole lot. Other people need an actual charging station at home. And the good news is that there are now rebates up to $250, I think, for a home electric vehicle charger. And that will be on our resource sheet. So if you're in the market for an electric vehicle, you want to be sure to check out this. Well, there's other rebates as well for just the purchase of the car, but now there's also rebates for the charger. If you're interested in electric vehicles, another thing I can recommend is that, again, on Saturday at the Mercer County Green Get-Together at Lawrence High School from 10 to 2, they're hosting what they're calling an electric vehicle meetup. There will be a number of people there who own electric vehicles. They'll be there with their cars and they'll be there to talk to you. They can share with you their experience. They can tell you what kind of charger they have and how often they have to charge and where they charge and all, you know, and maintenance, all those things, questions you might have. So I really encourage you, if you're thinking about an electric vehicle, this is a really good opportunity. So those are ways to electrify. We want to now move on to the third component, which is renewable energy. And for this, I'm going to turn it over first to Rex Parker, who's a member of our Green Team and also on the Hopewell Township Environmental Commission, to talk about energy sage, and he'll hand it off to someone from Exec Solar to talk more about residential panels, and then we'll come back to talk about some other things that you can do if you can't put panels on your house. There's still ways to get renewable energy, and I'll wrap that up with a Yvette Viasis. We'll talk about community solar, and I'll add a few other items. So I'm going to turn it over to Rex.
Unmute. Thank you, Joanne. I'm going to share here. Hang on one second. And here we go. You guys see this? So there's been a lot of advances in the field of solar energy and energy storage. And I'm just going to give a brief sketch of the situation as it exists here in New Jersey and talk about a program involving a company called Energy Sage that we've been closely involved with over the last several years. And I think it's a great option for people to consider if solar is in your future. New Jersey has been one of the first states to really ramp up its residential and business solar program. It was the early leader, in fact, ahead of California even. Even today, New Jersey has the most total solar PV installations, if you calculate per square mile, in the entire United States. Of course, we're a small state, so we don't have the most installs, but nonetheless, that's a pretty cool statistic to tell your friends. And as small as we are, we're producing the eighth highest amount of solar energy in terms of kilowatt hours, megawatt hours per year of all the states in the US. And there's been over 143,000 installations, many of them residential, majority residential, and 3.8. What's above the megawatt, the terawatt? 3,850 megawatts. So that's an impressive track record for New Jersey. And yet, with the goals Joanne mentioned at the beginning, the sobering reality we find ourselves in, the need to really shift to renewables, that impressive feat by New Jersey is still only 7%, less than 7% of the total electricity consumed by New Jerseyans. And with the goal of our governor and our state legislature that by 2050 to be 100% clean energy, you can see we've got a long ways to go. And obviously it's not only about solar, but we've got to up the ante here. The BPU has enacted and it has been approved a program to install another, basically double the amount of megawatt capacity in the state by 2030. Over three quarters of those are planned to be residential and small scale, and the rest will be large scale and community solar. We'll touch on the community solar point in a little bit. I won't get into it in my talk, but we'll come back to it later. The state is going to try to promote itself as a magnet for green jobs. Those are the visions coming from up top. Well, here in Hopewell Valley, we have been concerned about these ideas for a while. And back in 2017, we participated in a program with the Sustainable Jersey organization, what they called a solar challenge. And that was to see how many residents you could get in your township, or in our case, the boroughs and township, to install, to go through the whole process of analysis, specking out an installation of a solar PV system. We went up against seven other towns in the state, and we actually won the challenge. And there was a nice award that was given out for us winning the challenge. We had the most installations during 2017 of any town in the program. That award actually went to the Mercer County Vocational Technical School to help them jumpstart their renewable energy program at the school. And that was a kind of a cool thing we were able to do with the winnings there. But why I'm telling you this is that program did reach its conclusion, but Energy Sage, the company that was behind it, is still operating. And in fact, they still have some feelers out with New Jersey. They still have our connection through the website. Of course, they have connections with many, many towns and communities across the nation. Here's what it is. Energy Sage is a virtual company that created a system, a network of all the installers, many of the installers all across the country, all across the East Coast, the Mid-Atlantic, certainly across New Jersey. And the system works by you logging into the Energy Sage website and through their software, setting up an account and then being able to receive multiple online quotes for your solar installation. And you can compare prices, you compare sizes. They will do the work behind the scenes by the data that you enter, which would include things like how many kilowatt hours did you use per month over the last year, things like that. What we loved about this is that they really came through for numerous systems installed in our township. They were effective, they were efficient, and best of all, it did not trigger any of those annoying phone calls that we're all plagued with. No unwanted solicitations. The system really is solid in that respect. And most of the people who went through Energy Sage, both in our own township, but also across the boards, are saving 20% or more, and yet still retaining high quality systems. And so I was in touch with Energy Sage folks this week. They're based up in Boston. They have their headquarters. They cited some interesting stats in their progress in Mercer County, New Jersey since 2018. So after our solar challenge was over, they see about in their database, they can see about 100 customers in Mercer County installed solar photovoltaics using the Energy Sage system. Average size was just under 11 kilowatts capacity. Most of these were customer owned and self-financed, very few leases or personal power agreements. This is something we can come back to, but by far and away, most people are trying to build their own systems, and there are a lot of advantages of that. Although you do have to put out some initial investment, the advantages of owning your own system are that ultimately your system is going to be not only green energy, but green and money produced. You're going to break even and be positive somewhere down the road. And the break even point will depend on the system size, of course, but it's on my own particular case, our house. My wife and I put in a system back in 2004. We were one of the early adopters, and we were able to take advantage of some of the better incentives they had back in the early days, but those incentives still exist. What I wanted to say, though, is we broke even quite a few years ago, 5 or 6 years ago, and we've been in the green ever since. Still in the New Jersey system are net metering. So when you connect your solar system to the grid, and we totally advocate everybody being on the grid, then you are now net metering. And if you ever are in a situation, quite often around the clock, you're producing more solar energy than your house is consuming, then it's spinning the meter backwards. That's what we mean by net metering. The electricity companies are paying you retail rate for the electricity you produce. That's why it's such a great thing. There used to be a very valuable component called an SREC, a solar renewable energy credit. They've made a major transition through the BPU, and it's now called a New Jersey TREC, a transitional REC, but it's still worth $91 per year, and it's been fixed. It's no longer market-based. It's going to be fixed going forward, $91 per 1,000 kilowatt hours. That's a megawatt hour. For residential solar, $91 per, and a system our size, which is actually fairly small. We are about 6.2 kilowatts. We've been averaging about 8,000 kilowatt hours per year. So even there is, $700 per year that you're going to get for your system or more going forward. And right now, if you act this year and next year, 26 and 22%, of the initial capital outlay will be returned to you as a federal tax credit. Congress only renewed this thing through 2023, I believe. So that's another reason why acting in the near future is a good idea. Now, I wanted to just touch upon batteries. Energy Sage folks said only about a fourth of the respondents here in Mercer County showed interest in battery backup systems, and very few were actually installed. And I can't help but think that that has much to do with battery technology and where it has been, where it came from, even when we started out lead acid, the old school battery technology. We've gone through quite a learning curve on how to use a battery backup system while you're grid tied. But if you're in an area like we are in Hopewell, especially those of you on JCP&L, we have quite a few outages a year. When Hurricane Sandy came through years ago, we were without power for over 8 days. A battery backup system completely replaces your gas power generator and all the other approaches people are trying to take. And I really want to make a strong push for people to consider battery backup systems, because the advances in lithium ion batteries have become a real game changer in this situation. In fact, this last slide here shows a little bit about why I'm so excited in this. The discharge curve of a lead acid battery in the upper right in the blue curve, you can see it drops from initial 13 volts fully charged per typical 12 volt standard size lead acid battery. It drops below 12 volts when it's only 40% discharge, and then it crashes down with very minimal output. And the problem is you can only discharge a lead acid battery about 30 to 40% of its available capacity. This is sort of the dirty little secret of lead acid battery technology, the old school stuff. Otherwise, you'll destroy your battery, especially one that is designed to be long lived in a solar backup situation. You've got to stay within this 30-40% available capacity. Whereas lithium ion has a very flat discharge curve. It stays above 13 volts per unit battery until it's over 80% discharge. And that's what you have available to you. You can use these things down to 90% of the available capacity, recharge them with the sun the next day, and the battery's fine for hundreds, if not thousands of cycles. So it's a game changer. And as well, the increased capacity of solar panels, since we installed back in the day, 2004, we were at 185 watts per panel. They're well over 300 watts per panel now, depending on which vendor you go with. But I want to say that they're highly reliable. This whole system for us, our experience in real life has been high reliability. But I'll put the caveat, if properly designed, sourced and installed, and going cut rate is not the way to go here. You will pay in the end. So as I said, these are game-changing situations with the new panel technology and the new lithium ion. And I think I'm going to stop there, and I'm going to turn it over now to a real life expert in this field. And that is a friend and colleague who works for Exact Solar, which is a local company just across the river here in Yardley, PA. So I stop sharing. And Doug Edwards, if you would, please welcome to our session and please take it over with your slides.
Wonderful. Thank you. I really appreciate everybody having me here today. And I'm a talker, so please show the stop sign if I keep going. I'll do my best to keep it nice and succinct. All right, let me get my PowerPoint up. That was great, Rex. I really appreciate everything you covered there. Can you see my PowerPoint screen, everyone?
Good.
All right, great. Perfect. So yeah, Exact Solar, we're based in Bucks County. We do as much work in Central Jersey as we do in Bucks County because the market's been so strong. We've been around since 05. And we're about 30 team members. We do all the work ourselves. So we install, we service, and I bring that up now because if you have questions later about what's it like after, what's the reliability like, I'd love to talk to you about that because we have a division of our company called the Solar Orphan Service Division because we've inherited folks who their installers aren't around, and we take care of a lot of existing systems. So, and I think we can share, a lot of good experience from that. So Rex touched on a couple things. So I'll try to just touch on things that maybe we'll take it a step further rather than repeat anything he said. Reiterate that the tax credit is going down 26% of the cost of your system today. It'll be 22% next year. But you have to be done installing your project this year to get the 26%. So it takes, several months to get through all the approvals for interconnection and permit that are needed to do an installation. So if anybody is thinking about this year, it is, better to look at it earlier in the year rather than wait till the fall. You may have a hard time getting it in this year. However, we are very optimistic that some form or fashion of Build Back Better will happen, and it may not be anywhere near what they were trying to make happen, but it seems like solar tax credits are one of the things not being talked about a ton because I think there's a little bit of consensus on both sides that is good policy. So we're hoping in some form or fashion they do further extend the tax credits, but for now we have to assume that they're going down. It's been a very wild year and a half with the supply chain. For the first time in a long time in solar, costs have gone up and are projected to continue to come up. Our main supplier in Pensauk and CED, they supply a lot of the solar installers in the area. They just shared that module prices are going to go up 10 to 15 cents per watt by the end of this year across the board. And that's mostly, beyond the scope of the time we have here to explain that, I'd be happy to follow up with anybody on it. But as you can imagine, we've never seen costs go up in this industry. It's always been, every year the costs would get lower. So it's been a unique challenge that, we hope doesn't last forever, but it's the reality of the world we're in right now. But fortunately, the demand is still very strong. There's a lot of great installers out there. I love that you brought up Energy Sage. I can tell you, if you go on Energy Sage, you may see somebody from our team pop up and offer you a proposal. We're active on Energy Sage. We think Energy Sage buyers are very educated buyers because it's such a strong research site. And we've had a really great experience participating in it. So I encourage you to check that out. So if you're interested and you're thinking about your home, your installer is going to have to make sure to talk to you about your roof. You always want to get an inspection by the solar installer. Don't do a contract or proposal with anybody that hasn't really looked at your roof. We have amazing satellite tools today that most installers have. We still come out and look at your roof just to make sure that we don't want to put a system on a roof that's not in good condition or isn't on the newer side of things. And we're going to want to make sure that we really understand shade. We don't want you buying solar panels that you're not really going to get the benefit from. Part of what makes that, these things pay back to you is that they're really going to produce the energy that you expect them to produce, and you're really going to save on your utility bill. So things like really designing it properly, accurately accounting for shade, accurately accounting for other, site conditions are really important. So, it's a red flag if you see an installer try to race you through the process. This shouldn't be a race. You should take your time and get it right and make sure that you have a really well-designed system. This is just a quick look at the software that we use, and every installer has some variation of this, but it's great. There's 2D and 3D versions of it. It lets you, zoom in on the roof, and then all of what we do virtually will then go out on site to verify, and we'll do a nice CAD drawing of your layout. So we're, by the time you get through it, you'll have a really clear idea of what is going to go on your roof. Where is it going to go? It shouldn't be a surprise when the installers show up and they decide to put the modules on your roof. There's also very strict fire codes about access lanes that you have to allow. That didn't used to be, part of this industry as much, and they're extremely strict now. So, a lot of effort goes into this roof layout between the shade, between the fire codes, between, roof condition. You really, it's very important, but when you do it right, you can have a fantastic project, and you can save, as much or more energy than you could, have hoped for. Here's just an example of the 3D. I will tell you, the 3D is spectacular. We do find that it's very, very close to the on-site measurements. We'll be doing on-site measurements for a long time just because we think it's the right thing to do, but it's pretty impressive how great the 3D shading and simulation tools are. It's shockingly accurate today. So it's nice. It doesn't look that cool, but it does a really nice job. And one of the biggest things is inferring the pitch of the roof properly as well, and inferring shade from one roof section on another, not just shade from trees. So there's a lot of little things you might not think about, and it's pretty great. As I mentioned, we'll actually come out with a shade measurement tool. There's digital and analog shade measurement tools that the industry's used for a long time. You definitely want to see your solar installer come do that. As much as the software is great, you should have it verified. It's worth it. These are going to be expensive projects, and you don't want to miss something. You can have a conversation about tree trimming. We never advocate tree trimming because you've got the environmental balance there that you're always trying to do, but you can if you're open to it and it's something you want to do a little bit, you know, you can look at the shade tool to kind of help figure out what's, you know, a reasonable amount to do. Again, that's a touchy subject. And then you'll get a full economic analysis done. So what's great is, you know, we'll look at your utility bill for the last 12 months. We'll help look at the projected production of solar. We'll actually model how it's going to do about 0.5% degradation a year over time. They're rated to slightly, you know, produce a little bit less each year. So we'll model that. We'll actually, there's, you know, accurate rates built in there for PPL, PSE&G, you know, PICO over in PA. And then the performance-based incentive is the SREC. So we'll actually calculate what your SREC payments will be. They actually updated the TREC one more time, Rex. It's now 90. So not very different, but it's 90 now. So, but the good news is, like you said, it's 15 years set. So it's essentially a contract that you'll have. There's no market conditions you have to worry about. So, you know, this is going to be your analysis and it's going to be pretty accurate. And then the nice thing is there's three ways to pay for it. You can pay for it up front with cash, in which case your system costs won't carry on over the years like this. It'll just be all up front and then you'll have your savings and you can see. We're seeing in New Jersey like a 6 to 8 year payback right now because the SRECs are so good, the power rates are high, and you know, solar still is pretty cost effective to install today compared to years ago. So 6 to 8 years is a pretty reasonable New Jersey expectation. PA maybe is like 11 years because their SREC market is not as robust. Anyway, however you pay for it, you should be able to have a pretty black and white you know, forecast of what you're going to spend and what you're going to save. You shouldn't have a lot of surprises there. And any installer can help you do that. And the one thing I wanted to mention is that you can, if you need to upgrade your roof, you can include that in most solar financing programs. You can also include batteries in most solar financing programs, but you won't get the tax credit on the roof, but you will get the tax credit on the battery. So if you install battery without solar, you don't get tax credit on it. But if you install battery with solar, you will get the 26% tax credit. And interesting that you mentioned that about the Energy Sage battery statistic. I can tell you just from our own experience, one out of every three projects we do today has a battery on it. So we're seeing a tremendous level of interest in it. And it's for a lot of reasons. I mean, you know, the power outages are getting worse every year. Battery costs have come down. And really the technology that makes the battery and solar work together intelligently has probably progressed the most. So, you know, when you'd buy a battery before, you had it, it wasn't very elegant how well it played with solar in your house and really, you know, kind of worked for you. The automation systems now that coordinate all of that have just really progressed. And I think that's driven a lot of the surging interest because it's really made it a lot more practical. Again, touched on the tax credit. It does go to zero as of right now after 2023. So I don't think it's as big a deal to go to 26 to 22, but boy, I hope they, you know, this is an important part of the industry. I really do hope they extend it in some form or fashion. Let's see. I will note every utility company in the area raised rates around December, January. PICO was 6%. Everybody was 5, 6, 7%. Nothing new, happens every year, but it's a little friendly reminder. When you go solar, you're locking in your power costs for the next 30 years. You're going to have that long of a warranty on all your equipment. And you know, your PICO is not going to be guaranteeing you that their rate stays where it is today for the next 30 years, or PPL or PSE&G. They're all the same. They're all, you know, increasing at the same rate. So we always kind of ask folks to think about it this way. You know, once you invest in this, and if you finance it, which is the most common approach taken, you know, that mortgage payment on your solar system basically replaces your power bill, and it's going to be fixed just like your home mortgage, you know, is fixed as opposed to rising power costs. I did mention the SREC program. It's a 15-year guarantee. And in New Jersey, we're seeing the systems pay for themselves almost twice in 15 years. So, it's a really, really strong incentive. Net metering is a really important concept. So when you install a solar system on your home, you can almost get, we have to oversize it in the summer and it's going to be undersized in the winter. And so what happens is most of the summer, it's going to generate more than your home needs and it's going to spin the meter backwards. And the grid is going to act like a giant virtual battery for you, at least from a billing standpoint. And then as solar production goes down at night or into the fall and winter when it's at its lowest, you will be taking more from the grid than you were in the summer. And so now you're spinning the meter the other way. And they will give you over a 12-month period, dollar for dollar, kWh for kWh credit for those. It's a fully reimbursable virtual piggy bank for your power, which is really, really amazing because the utility still has to maintain the lines and keep everything working so that you can take the power when you need it, when your solar array is not producing anything. So it's a pretty strong incentive for solar to have that because it really makes the economics work much better than they would if you were trying to do standalone solar where you were not grid tied. You would have to build a lot bigger system to be fully renewable off grid. And you'd need batteries. So net metering is a really big deal. So I just looked at a 19.
Just a couple minutes more, Doug.
Yeah, sure. So I think this is my last, I can end on this. So a typical system for a home, this is a larger home. This is a 19 kW system. So, we're using we just started using 400 watt panels now. So that's our standard is a 400 watt panel. So, for a 19 kW home, the installation is the environmental equivalent of planting 1500 trees. So this is right off the EPA's website. They have a carbon equivalency calculator. I'm sure you've all used some form or fashion of it at some point. And you just take the energy produced by this system and plug it in the calculator and it's 1500 trees. So to think that one home can make that impact, while it's a good financial decision for you as a homeowner, we're really here more than anything for the environmental aspect of it. And as panels have increased and things have become more cost effective, it's really exciting to see the impact that one home can make. So thank you.
Great. Thank you. We're going to save questions. And I know there's some about batteries in the chat box, but I want to move on to our next speaker who's going to talk about community solar. This is something that could become an option for you if you really can't do solar on your house. If you've got all those trees that we don't want to cut down, community solar could be a solution for you. It's just coming into its own. I'm really excited to have Yvette Viasis here from Solar Landscape to sort of describe to us how it's working and give us a peek into what might be happening in the very near future. So Yvette.
Right. Thank you, Joanne. So, our company is Solar Landscape, and we're going to talk about community solar and the program that New Jersey has built out to support what you mentioned are the barriers to entry into the renewable energy transition. And usually those barriers are owning your own home. So usually you'll have to own your home in order to put solar on it. You also need the right rooftop, and it needs to make financial sense to you. You need to be able to afford it or have the right credit limits. So New Jersey has found a way or built out a program to include everyone into its transition to renewable energy, including the solar transition. So it was through the Clean Energy Act of 2018 that the Board of Public Utilities announced that they would have a community solar program. The goal of the program is environmental justice by investing in communities to reduce electricity costs, allow for massive amounts of solar to be implemented in order to clean our air, and divest from any type of dirty sources of energy. It's also meant to bring access to solar energy for everyone and improve local workforce development in renewable energy fields, including job training, school enrichment programs, and stuff like that. So in a very simple way, this program works by having developers like Solar Landscape apply to build massive solar projects in communities throughout New Jersey. And these projects can be built on industrial warehouses or brownfields or areas like that. No green fields. And once we build this project, or once it's awarded to us, we can build it and put all of that energy into the local grid. So as you see here, that energy is being connected straight into the local grid. And then once it's on that grid, it can power your apartment or your house, as long as you fit within the boundary of the project. And so generally, the boundary of the projects are going to be for the town in adjacent towns or the county in adjacent counties. Generally, the one that the BPU gives a higher credit or score to are the ones with the more localized boundary lines. So most of our projects will serve the town and adjacent towns, but we do have a couple county and adjacent county serving projects. But yeah, once you're on one of these projects, you receive a discounted energy or discounted renewable energy credit on your utility bill, on your PSE&G bill. All right. And so just to give you a quick timeline of, you know, how this has progressed, 2018, you know, the Clean Energy Act was approved, and the first year of applications was in 2019, where it announced around 75 megawatts worth of projects would be accepted. And it was a very competitive program. It had 252 applications, and it awarded those applications in 2019. And then since then, projects have been built. We received 20 megawatts worth of the 77 megawatts that were awarded. And then in 2021, the second round of community solar went live, and equally as competitive. This time they doubled the capacity for community solar. So they allowed for 150 megawatts worth of community solar. And that just seems to be the trend, that they're going to allow for 150 megawatts and potentially a little bit more each year of the permanent program. They shortened the three-year pilot program to just be a two-year pilot program and move immediately into the permanent program. So that's really exciting news. And now Solar Landscape received 46 out of the 106 projects that were awarded in the state. And we're working on building those out for this new year. Again, they were approved in October of 2021. So we're just moving through and working on getting those live for everyone in New Jersey. So again, the idea of community solar, just a brief overview, is that you no longer need to have panels on your rooftop in order to take in the benefits of solar energy. You can be a part of a local project in your neighborhood or near your neighborhood. It's providing an access route for everyone to be a part of this. It doesn't matter if you're a renter. It doesn't matter if you are low income or are higher income. The way to sign up is very easy. All you need to do is find a project near you and go through their subscription portal. And so all of our projects are on gosolarlandscape.com currently for round one. And I'll show you that little link later on, but every project or developer has their own sign-up page, and it's a pretty easy, you know, you just put in your account number and a couple more pieces of information to see how you qualify. And as long as there's a space and capacity in the project, you'll be able to jump into the project. There are no credit or income limitations, no costs associated to being a part of the projects. So there are no sign-up fees, at least none related to Solar Landscapes projects, to sign up or cancel. And you could even take it, as long as you're moving to another boundary within our project service area, you can take your subscription and move when you move, and just let us know and we'll be able to help you out. And again, this is all about making sure that New Jersey can make its transition into zero emission energy. And now that we've talked about community solar a little bit, I just wanted to put in a little bit about our company. We are a New Jersey-based company based in Asbury Park. And right now we are a leading community solar developer with the largest portfolio that serves low-income communities. But we serve all communities within our service area. We won the 2021 New Jersey Governor's Environmental Excellence Award for climate change and clean air. So we were very excited about that. And we've just been doing a lot of work within the community to make sure that the community aspect of community solar is really prioritized within our projects and in our efforts. This is a quick map showing where our boundary lines, what they include. And as you can see, we have all of Mercer County, basically, that's on the PSCNG grid that can subscribe to our current projects from round one, actually. And we will also have another round two project that will be included in our capacity. So we do currently have capacity for people to subscribe to the projects. As you can see here, you could sign up today at gosolarlandscape.com. And if you use the promo code, I forgot to include that on here, a promo code GTHVS. So that's the one that we got for this, GTHVS, I'll put it on there. We'll be able to send you out a $50 Visa gift card and guarantee that your discount is 20 or 25%. And so normally for most of our projects from round one, the discount level that we applied for was a 10 to 15% discount. For round two of the program, our projects were from 20%. So when we work with green teams or any type of partner, we like to sort of give back to the community in giving a higher discount to those subscribers. So anyone who subscribes with that promo code as part of this webinar and just generally from engagement through the green team, they'll be able to receive a 20 or 25%, 25% going to communities that qualify as low to moderate income, and then a $50 Visa gift card. And again, this program is really just, it's a state initiative that's overseen by the BPU. It's not third party energy. It's sort of really engaging a local and community driven aspect to energy. So that's a brief view on what community solar is. And if you have any questions, you can feel free to let me know. Here's my information. So you can also feel free to email me or call for any questions that you may have while you're subscribing or whatever the case may be.
Thank you, Yvette. Thank you for giving us a sort of a really quick snapshot of what's going on. And it's exciting to know that there already are opportunities for community solar. We'll make sure that your website is on our resource page that we're putting together. I just wanted to mention there's one other way that, and Yvette just alluded to it, that you could try and purchase renewable. There are third-party providers in the state, and some of them do offer an option for renewables, but you have to, and the BPU webpage where you can find them all will be on our resource page. Be really careful because they change their programs. I did it a couple of times and then they said, no, we're not going to do renewables anymore. So you have to keep checking on them and they might change your rate if you're not watching carefully. So, but it's worth doing if there's no other option, I guess. That's my spin on it. I guess, can you stop sharing, Yvette? So then we'll, time for just a couple of final questions. I see that some of the battery questions were already addressed in the chat. I appreciate that people were doing that. I'm going to make my final pitch, and then anybody wants to stay around for final questions, is that commit yourself to something. Having heard all of this, think of one thing at least that you can do first, and then after that, do another thing. We think that probably if you need a little bit of moral support, make yourself a buddy plan. Find a neighbor or a friend who's also doing these things and work on it together. But also feel free to reach out to our green team. I'm putting in the chat a couple things. One is the link for all the Mercer County Sustainability Coalition stuff that's happening later this week on the 28th and the 30th. You can go there to get the details. I'm also putting in our green team email address and gmail.com. So feel free to contact us that way. It's really great for us to know what your questions are, and we can tap into lots of people to find answers to them. And so This is my pitch. I'm going to now just open it up to final questions for anybody who can stay. And I want to thank everybody who did come tonight, and especially thank all of our presenters for really, really great and in-depth presentations in a very short period of time. So thank you for that. Any additional questions? You can raise your hand or put it in the chat. I think you can unmute yourself if you want to ask a question.
Well, I might make a comment that, you know, I definitely want to kind of back up Scott in terms of, you know, the initial strategy of, you know, it's better to not burn it than to burn it. And I will tell you that my own experience was, is that I was able to, following some of the very same principles that Scott laid out, when I started probably maybe like 3 or 4 years ago, I've been able to cut the consumption of, you know, gas and all of the other utilities in half, less. I mean, I now typically will get bills that tell me, here's the optimal house and here's where you're at below it. And I think that there's a lot of wisdom in what Scott shared, but I certainly don't want to take away from what anybody else has said, because I think that when you add all these together, we get there.
Yeah. And can I ask a question then? Maybe Scott would know the answer. I've heard, we tell people just get an audit, start with an audit, but there's audits and there's consultations. There seems to be a spectrum of, advice that you can get. Could you maybe clarify something about that?
Sure. So when people are driven by, the incentives from the utilities now, lots of times, you know, they'll start with a consultation, you know, before an audit. And it's interesting because a lot of people are kind of enamored by the amount of money that potentially could come to fund the project. But if you've already done a high efficiency furnace a couple of years ago, and you've already done, maybe you put a heat pump water heater in, then those incentives are really coupled around replacing heating and air conditioning equipment and doing insulation and air sealing. So it really depends what the homeowner is looking at and what state their current equipment is in. So, you know, a consultation first, and then, you know, that could bloom into a full-blown audit. And it's really a conversation between the salesperson and the homeowner.
Okay, great. Thank you. There was a question in the chat about batteries and just sort of the environmental impact of lithium mining. I guess we're hearing that a lot, especially with like lawn equipment and that sort of things. Anybody want to weigh in on that?
That's to you, Doug.
You know, the most popular battery we've seen folks get excited about right now is actually not lithium ion, it's lithium iron phosphate, which is the newer chemistry that's really kind of got the industry a buzz. And Sonnen is actually rated fully recyclable. So that's, I can't speak to the mining of the elements. It's just not out of my expertise personally, but I will say the recyclable aspect of the lithium iron phosphate Sonnen battery is really something that, I've had a lot of customers seek. And it actually performs slightly better on the deep cycle than even the lithium ion, and they last longer. Some of them are rated for almost 30 years now. So it's definitely a sign of where things are going, I'd say, more than anything, because I'm sure in a couple of years, something will even outpace that, right? It's just been really, really tremendous to see batteries starting to go down that technology curve and cost curve and, you know, recyclability, and just the market's maturing in all ways, you know.
So any other questions? I know we went really fast. We just want this to be part of a continuing conversation if possible. Scott, were you raising your hand or just saying hello?
You're on Scott Fulmer.
Sorry, the other Scott. Yeah. Scott, do you want to put something in the chat?
No, I can. Now you can hear me?
Okay.
What about passive solar? Is that still a thing? My dad was an architect in the 80s, and the house that he designed for us had these tubes with some sort of salt that would absorb heat from the sun, and then forest hot air would be blowing through this attic area where these tubes were. That was the idea. No silicon involved. And then when I was out in Florida, I noticed there was a roof on a condo that had, I think, water being heated on the roof. It's just a different technology. Just was wondering if that's still in development.
So we actually started doing only solar thermal in 2005. And at this point, I joke that we're like the last Jedi for solar thermal in the area. We get about 10 calls a week from people saying, I heard you guys still do solar thermal. And it's really cool technology. The problem is it's a little more maintenance intensive. It can leak, and not that many people work on it anymore. So it can be expensive to maintain long-term just because there's not really anybody that does it. Because of that, we've been steering folks more and more to solar PV. I think solar PV's firmly crossed it over from like a return on investment standpoint. And what we're really finding is a lot of those applications, we're putting in pool heat pumps now, you know, air to water heat pumps for pool heating. We're putting in, you know, the domestic, you know, water heaters with electric, especially the heat pump hybrid domestic water heaters. And so, you know, with solar, with EV charging, with pool heat pumps, you know, it's really becoming like the electric renewable home. And the thing we always say with solar thermal versus PV is, you know, once you've met your water demand, you're kind of wasting the sun energy, where the electric, when your pool doesn't need that heat anymore, like it's just going to something else in the home. So it's the utilization effectiveness of the PV is, you know, a lot stronger. But it's really cool technology. We just don't see it much anymore. So,
okay, thanks.
Yeah.
Just one question in terms of kind of, you know, I've heard anecdotally, so I cannot say I'm qualified, but the recyclability of PV, you know, today's panels, I thought that there was a challenge of, you know, the 30-year-old panels that are now coming up for, you know, replacement, they have difficulty recycling those. What's the current state right now?
I can tell you, we do have difficulty with that. We really do. We get asked to, you know, remove old modules occasionally, you know, for somebody that maybe has got a 20-year-old system that just wants to, you know, do an upgrade. And it's, you know, it's tough. There are some providers that will come and, you know, for a fee, you know, take them and recycle them. But they're a little tough to coordinate with. There's not a lot of them. I do though envision that, like most things, as the market demands a lot more of that, there's not that many PV systems coming out of, you know, operation, because they do last a really long time, and they haven't been around that long as an industry. So I think we will see a lot more of that. And I anticipate that the services that we need for that recycling will ramp up as it becomes, you know, less of a one-off and much more of a common, you know, need.
Great. Any more questions? I added a few things to the chat so that you can follow up on resources, our webpage. So Scott Fulmer will be getting us, getting our web resources loaded in about by the end of the week. I just have to finish compiling them all the different things we've talked about tonight, and especially links to some of our presenters tonight, so you can follow up with them as well. We'll be on that resources page. So is there anything else that people would like to raise? If not, thank you all for being here tonight. It's been a really great way to end Hopewell Valley Green Week, I think, and to know that there's so many people out there who really care about doing what they can to protect the environment. It's gratifying. So thank you, everybody. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, folks. Thank you.
Bye, everyone.
All right. Good night.